I feel it. We're hyped for God. Oh. And we're going to give it all with our hearts. And let's just go ahead and introduce ourselves.
We're going to sweat for the Lord right now.
Yes.
We're going to give it all to Him.
And let's just go ahead and start off. We are in Fuego Youth Ministry. It's a blessing to be a leader, blessing to be here, to be a part of something greater, something for the Lord. My name is Wendy.
I'm Jalissa.
And I'm Raul.
And let's get started with today's word.
Yes, so today's topic is the grace of God. Ooh. And so we're going to be sharing a little bit of what we think that means and how God shows us His grace. So para este radio, el podcast, nuestro tema es la gracia de Dios. So vamos a hablar sobre qué significa la gracia de Dios y cómo podemos mirar su gracia. So I wanted to start off by reading Hebrews 4:16, and it reads... Okay, it says, where is it at? Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our times of need. So why I chose this is because it tells us straight, like clearly here, that when we go through hard times, when we're going through our tribulations, we can go straight to God's throne and ask for His grace, and He will show us His grace. You know, as a Christian, sometimes life can get even harder than it is in the world because the devil feels threatened of you. And, you know, the devil knows that God has shown us His grace. Like we were talking about yesterday in Bible study, how we're not under the same law as we were, like as the people were in the past. Like they would commit sins and they were like, okay, you're sentenced to death. And, you know, we're not like, we're not under that law anymore. Jesus came, died for all of our sins, and He broke that law. Now we're under the law of grace that, like, no matter how many times we fail God, He's always going to be there. No matter what we can do, like the song was saying, like the prodigal son who, like, left, and then God received him back because of His grace. It is because of His grace. And I feel like all we have to do is go to God and ask for His grace. And now we have the privilege to be able to just go up to the altar, to His presence, and ask for that. Because in the past, you know, you weren't able to just go to His altar. We see that in the Old Testament, the people back when they had the Ark of... I don't know how you say it in English, but it was an Ark. And they would go and they would instantly die because they weren't worthy to be in that presence. The presence was too much for them, that they had to go through different steps to, in order for them to, like, even be able to get to the, to get to the altar. And, like, if we look at it now, it's like if you were to only make it past the door, like, you know, the hallway of our church, that's where you would get to be. You wouldn't even be able to get to worship inside.
So many bodies on the floor.
Yes. Like, yeah, like, you weren't, like, it was so much laws, like we were talking about yesterday. It was so many things that us as human beings, we couldn't even fulfill all of that, that God had to send His only Son. And it is through His grace that now we are, like it was saying, like we own everything because, like, God owns us. Like, because we're with God, we're like, we own everything. And that shows us that even in our hard times, we got to remember we have a merciful, like it was saying, if we go up to Him, we may receive mercy and find grace in our help in our times of need. So if we just go to God, He's going to show us His grace and His mercy. It says, like in another verse, it says God is slow to anger and great in mercy. So, like, never doubt that God, like, that you've gone too far, because you haven't. And then I also wanted to read 1 Peter 5:10, which also talks about, like, times of hardships, which also, like, proves that, like, being a Christian isn't easy. Like, we're gonna go through these hardships, but we have the person who has all the answers and who's gonna help us through everything. And it says, And the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. So it's showing us that sometimes we may endure suffering, but it says just for a little while, like a little while, but then He's going to make us stronger and firm. And, like, I feel like through that process, through that suffering, it's going to make us even more stronger, and it's going to make us firm, like I said, being trustworthy in God, that, like, Raul once said, like, the plant, like, even though it may go through so many things, it's not gonna go down to the floor. It's gonna come right up because we're gonna be firm, and our roots are gonna be good, and it's just make us stronger. And through Christ, because of his grace, we're gonna be able to endure everything, because on our own strength we can't endure nothing. Like, that's why it says, like, God doesn't give someone a burden they can't handle with his strength. Like, because if it was for our own will, we wouldn't be able to endure anything. Our roots would be so weak that our tree would fall. But with God, we're gonna be firm, and we're gonna be good, and we're gonna stand straight, and we're gonna have that victory because of his grace. So I feel like that's what his grace means to me, and that's what I was studying, that, like, even in our hardships, like, it's God's grace at the end of the day that's gonna get us through the day.
So, amen.
Yeah.
I just want to add one thing. Real quick. I'm trying not to watch, like, movies and shows, so I watch, like, stuff that's supposedly boring, like how things are made. And they were talking about industrial chains. And industrial chains, before they can get sold out, they have to be tested. And I feel like we are getting tested before, to bring our value up, to bring our skill set up. You know what I mean? Because if that chain breaks, doesn't matter how much material, how big it is, how thick it is, it's useless, because its purpose doesn't fulfill its, because it, yes. And I feel like that's God testing us with his grace in us. Because you can have, you know, all the money, you can have the best friends, the best education, but if you don't do anything with it, you're not out there making moves, you're not out there, like, bringing people to Christ, speaking to them, like, Circle K or in a bus, or I don't know, yeah, like, taking chances, like, what kind of a chain are you, you know?
Yeah. If you're not using God's skill set, the word he gave you, the wisdom he's given you, what's the point of knowing the Bible if you don't apply it to your own life?
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, that's perfect. So, yo quería leer Hebreos 4:16 para empezar sobre hablando la gracia de Dios, y dice: acerquémonos pues confiadamente al trono de la gracia para alcanzar misericordia y hallar gracia para el oportuno socorro. Son otras palabras, vamos a pasar por cosas difíciles en nuestras vidas. Como cristianos, a veces es mucho más duro de lo que fuera si estuvieras en el mundo, porque el diablo está enojado que ya no estamos bajo la ley de antes. Ahora tenemos su gracia, estamos abajo de la ley de su gracia, que podemos hacer lo que sea y realmente arrepentirnos, y Dios nos va a perdonar, nos va a recibir con sus brazos abiertos. Y eso, el enemigo está enojado, pero es por su gracia que podemos hallar, like, misericordia hacia Dios. Y como estábamos leyendo ayer sobre Romanos 8, todo lo estábamos leyendo y va perfectamente con la, el tema de hoy. Porque estábamos leyendo sobre la ley de antes, que nadie, o nosotros como humanos, no podemos llevar todo lo que la ley decía que tuvo Dios que mandar a su único hijo para poder sobrepasar todo del mundo y nosotros poder hallar su gracia y poder ser perdonados y poder tener todo lo que Dios tiene nosotros también por su gracia. Y eso nos enseña, porque antes, like, estaba diciendo que ahora podemos ir a su trono y poder hallar gracia. So, eso está en Primera de Pedro 5:10 y dice: mas el Dios de toda gracia, que nos llamó a su gloria eterna en Jesucristo, después que hayáis padecido un poco de tiempo, él mismo os perfeccionará, afirme, fortalezca y establezca. So, en otras palabras, ya que, like, váyanos por los, like, tiempos difíciles que vamos a pasar, Dios nos va a dar las fuerzas y nos va a afirmar y nos va a establecer, y vamos a estar bien, porque podemos ahora ir hacia él y pedirle perdón y pedirle ayuda y pedirle su gracia y su misericordia para que nos pueda ayudar, porque en otro versículo dice que Dios es lento para la ira y grande en misericordia. So, lo que sea que podamos pasar, Dios va a tener misericordia. Ahora podemos ir al altar y pedirle, like, uno a uno a él que nos ayude, porque si miramos en el Antiguo Testimonio, donde era Moisés, no podían entrar a la presencia, a la arca de paz. ¿O qué era la arca? El pacto de algo. So, ellos no podían entrar ahí. No podían entrar ahí. Porque instantemente se morían, tenían que durar un año sin pecar y ni podían entrar hasta adentro, tenían que entrar, podían nomás llegar hasta donde estaban todas las túnicas. Y es como ahora, si lo miramos, es como si tú entras a la iglesia y nomás estás en el pasillo. No, todavía no puedes entrar a poder adorar y mucho menos poder ir al altar. Y ahora tenemos ese privilegio de poder ir libremente al altar y pedir perdón y pedirle por su ayuda, porque antes era muy difícil. Imagínense un año sin pecar, sin enojarte, sin hacer nada. Eso era casi imposible, y por eso Jesús tuvo que venir y poder llevar todo para que nosotros pudiéramos hallar gracia en Él. So, ahora nosotros somos muy afortunados de poder tener eso. Y como ayer estábamos diciendo, el hermano Motoya estaba diciendo, que muchas veces nos aprovechamos de esa gracia, de su misericordia, y tenemos que recordar, no tenemos que hacer así, porque antes era difícil y ahora nosotros somos muy afortunados y le tenemos que dar gracias que ahora podemos hallar perdón y misericordia. Y a pesar de todas las pruebas que lleguen, vamos a estar bien porque vamos a estar firme. Como el Raúl estaba diciendo una vez en su predica, que un árbol, si tiene sus raíces bien, nada malo le va a pasar. Ahorita que está pasando los monsoons, va a estar bien, se va a sacudir un poquito, y va a perder unas branches y hojas, sí, pero va, al último del día ahí va a estar el árbol, aunque esté un poquito pelón, pero ahí va a estar parado y otra vez va a poder dar sus hojas y sus frutas y sus flores. Y nosotros así también, a lo mejor a veces nos van tocar que nos sacudemos, empezar de nuevo para poder florecer, dar buenos frutos, y nos va a dar nosotros vamos a estar firme con su ayuda y por su gracia. So eso significa para mí su gracia de Dios, que sea lo que hagamos, siempre vamos a hallar su gracia y su misericordia si realmente nos arrepentimos y no andemos jugando juegos, porque con Dios no se puede jugar. Y su gracia es muy grande. So nunca dudes que porque te fuiste, no puedes regresar como el hijo pródigo. Todo va a estar bien y Dios te va a perdonar.
Amen.
Julissa had so many great points. Kind of want to add on, but I want to start off with my verse first, because I feel like everything just connects so well. God is so good. So my verse in 1 Corinthians 15, it says, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace towards me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me." So this verse is talking about Paul, right? We all know who Paul was. He persecuted Christians. He killed them. He brought them. He jailed them, or he put them in prisons. Yeah, that sounds better. He put them in prisons. But God still went, found him where he was, and used him. Regardless of everything that Paul did against Christians, everything he did against those that believed, that praised God, that spoke the word of God, against everything, he was still chosen against his, and that's only with the grace of God, how Julius was saying, everything is only through the grace of God, through the grace that he sent his one and only son down to this earth, to die for our sins. Because if it wasn't for that, Paul wouldn't have been forgiven. But because our God is so great, so almighty, so merciful, Paul was forgiven. Not only that, he was given a second life. He was given an opportunity to show his worth, his worthiness to Christ. And he did that. He followed Jesus. He spoke the word of God. He proved those in his village wrong and showed them how he changed for Christ. Imagine all these people telling him, you haven't changed, You killed those people. Would you say that you love Jesus? What do you mean that you follow him, that you believe, that you're a Christian? What, like, who are you? Like, you're not Paul. Like, Paul killed these people. And it says here, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. It was God's grace that transformed him, that changed him. And then it continues to say, and his grace towards me was not in vain, because he didn't allow this second opportunity to be wasted. No, Paul continuously, time after time, after he was the one being persecuted, after he was the one being thrown in jail, thrown in chains, beaten up by those that he knew because he chose to follow Jesus. It wasn't in vain what Jesus did in his life, the transformation. He still continued time and time after everything to be faithful, to change his life around. He still, even in prison, even when he was down, even when they had kicked him, when they had beat him up, when he was down low on the ground, he couldn't get up, he was chained up, he still praised, he still worshiped, and his chains were broken. He was freed, and continuously he went back to preach, just for him to be thrown back in jail, just for him to be beat up again. But he still went out there and he said, you know what, God's grace wasn't in vain, and I'm gonna continuously do this. And if you read chapter 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it talks about the resurrection of Christ and how it's only possible because Jesus died and resurrected the third day. It says a couple verses above, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. He knew his wrongdoings. We know where we go wrong. We know where we fail. We know. But God knows as well. Jesus knew as well. Jesus saw Paul. He saw all he did. But he knew, by the grace of God, by his goodness, by his love, by just everything that Jesus, God, and his Holy Spirit are, we're allowed to be transformed. We're allowed to give it to him and to just be freed from our chains. Because it's not necessarily a chain that the world puts on us. It's a chain we put on ourselves. Because I can imagine Paul thought he was unworthy after killing the people that served this great and almighty God, after putting them in chains, after persecuting them time and time after again. And then finding out how great the grace of God is, you don't think he felt unworthy of God's presence? I would have felt unworthy. I feel unworthy sometimes. I feel like I fail at times. I feel like sometimes I don't prioritize Christ as I should. But I come to him. I kneel down. I'm not ashamed to talk of his word. I'm not ashamed to set that time aside to pray, that time aside to read his word, that time aside to watch preachings, to be filled up by his glory, by his presence. But there is times where sometimes we feel like we're not worthy of his word, worthy of his presence, because we fail. But by the grace of God, we're given the second chance, second opportunity to be renewed in his presence, renewed in what he says of us. Because it doesn't matter what anyone says. It doesn't matter what you think of yourself. It doesn't matter what the world thinks of you. Because God has found us as we are. We are found in Christ. As we are used. We are transformed. We are changed. And we're here. We're here serving. He knows our past. He knows where we came from. Some of us grew up here in this church, and some of us didn't care about Christ, but we are here today, and all that matters is that tomorrow we're continuously trying to receive of his presence. We are hungry, and I said something last week, we're being extra for God. I'm going to praise him more. I'm going to receive of his presence more. I'm going to receive of his word more. I'm going to receive of his wisdom more. I'm going to receive of the community he's placed me of this relationship with one another, because it's not just me growing alone. I want to grow with Jalissa. I want to grow with Raul, with Gio, with La Hermana. I want to grow with everyone in Enfuego, because that's the most beautiful part of being a part of a community, is I've found myself. God has found me as I am, and he's found each and every one of us as we are, and he's shown us our grace, his grace. He's shown us his grace, his love, his mercy, his goodness. And we come together and we praise him up together. It's easier to worship, guys. It's easier to worship when there's other people that feel the atmosphere of God's presence. It's easier to worship when there's other people ready and hungry to receive and to give to God all that it is that we can give to Him. Right? Like, am I wrong?
Amen. Amen. Let's be extra. I like that because it's usually used in a negative connotation. Like, oh, Becky's being extra again. Like, no, let's be extra for God in a good way, because I don't mean to talk bad about God or anything, but, like, He loves us way too much.
Yeah.
Like, way too much. Like, I don't deserve it. I know you guys, I'm not trying to be mean, but we don't deserve
it. We don't,
You guys are pretty great. Not that great. No, just kidding. But I wanted to say that because I didn't want to say that to the people because they might take it unpersonally. But you guys know, like, you guys are great students. You guys go through a lot of stuff. You guys show up here. You guys got jobs. The world is crazy. It's full. It's hectic. And for you to just be able to get those tasks done without serving God, like, that seems like enough for some people. And what blows my mind is, like, I could never even get those things done if I didn't get fueled up by the Lord, like a pit stop, because His grace reminds me that, like, I'm not saying it's a get out of jail free card, because a lot of people, some people take it that way, but it like takes the guardrails off to be able to try things and not be scared of it. It takes the guardrails off to be like, I'm nervous to talk to this person about God, even though I see them shedding a tear over there. Maybe I should just go talk to them.
Yeah.
And God gives us that. He gives us that strength, and He gives us that that motivation by telling us, you know, He has love for us even though we don't deserve it. Did you say yours in Spanish?
I'm just going to read the verse quickly. Okay. So, en mi versículo, en primero de Corintios 15 a 10, lee, pero lo que soy, lo soy por la gracia de Dios, y su gracia no ha sido en vano, porque he trabajado más que todos ellos. Si bien es cierto que no he sido yo, sino la gracia de Dios que ha obrado por medio de mí. Y estos, Pablo está hablando de él perseguía a los cristianos, él los mataba, él los echaba en las prisiones, y Dios todavía vino a su vida, todavía lo usó sabiendo quién era él, qué hacía él a las personas que amaban a Dios, qué hacía a las personas que Dios amaba, y todavía fue en la vida de Pablo, lo usó, lo levantó, lo cambió, lo transformó a un seguidor de Dios. Y eso es algo que no más puede ser Dios, porque yo puedo imaginar que a veces él se sintió como él no era digno de la presencia de Dios, no era digno de ser seguidor de Jesús por todo lo que ha hecho, sabiendo que un día él iba atrás de los cristianos, él iba, los mataba, los echaba en prisiones, los trataba mal, y ahora que él conoce la gracia de Dios, el amor de Dios, como alguien, si yo estaba en su vida, si yo era esa persona que yo decía todas estas malas cosas de Raúl, de Julissa, que yo me burlaba de ellos, les pegaba, no les pego, no me burlo, no nada, pero si eran esos tiempos, les pegaba, les tiraba rocas, me burlaba de ellos y agarraba a las otras personas que vengan, nos vamos a burlar de ellos, ellos creen en Dios, ¿sabes qué? Los vamos a echar en la cárcel, ellos no deben estar libres por creer en un Dios falso. Y si por mí ellos pierden la vida por mi culpa, yo me hubiera sentido feo después, sabiendo la gracia, el amor de Dios, sabiendo que su Dios ahora es mi Dios, el Dios que ellos alababan ahora es el Dios que yo alabo. ¿Quién soy yo para recibir la gracia, el amor de Dios, si yo era tan malo con los hijos de Dios, con los seguidores de Dios, con sus servientes? ¿Quién soy yo para recibir la gracia de Dios? Y a veces muchos de nosotros nos sentimos así por nuestro pasado, por lo que hemos dicho antes, por lo que hemos hecho antes con otros cristianos, con gente allá afuera. A veces nos sentimos como no somos dignos de su presencia, de su amor, de recibir de él, de de recibir del amor que Él tiene, porque es un amor tan grande que Él mandó su único hijo aquí por nuestros pecados, para poder ser perdonados por nuestro pasado. Y Él está diciendo aquí, pero lo que soy, lo soy por la gracia de Dios, porque no más puede ser Dios quien nos cambia, no más puede ser Dios en donde somos transformados, usados, somos nuevas personas y podemos ir allá afuera, ir y alabar y traer la palabra y traer la presencia de Dios y podemos levantar naciones. No más es por la gracia, el amor y por todo, por Dios. Porque Él es un Dios grande, Él nos da segundas oportunidades y no más se puede hacer con Él. No hay nada más que nos puede cambiar el corazón, pero Dios.
Amén. Y qué bueno, qué cosa de Dios es usar a alguien que no, que toda la gente va a decir, ese nunca lo va a usar Dios. Y Dios lo usa. Es la definición de cómo nosotros deberíamos de sentir ahorita. Porque a lo mejor vives tu vida pensando, oh, pues lo que yo he hecho años para atrás. Eso es lo que el Satanás usa como cadenas arriba de ti para que no hagas esa decisión para seguir a Dios. Pero Dios está diciendo en esta historia que no importa lo que ha pasado, Dios te recibe como el hijo pródigo, te abraza, te perdona y te hace de nuevo otra vez. Y como dijo Wendy, yo me imagino que lloró en veces que, por las cosas que hizo, porque sí hizo daño, pero él sabe, él entiende Dios, sí, tiene esa relación tan cerca con Dios, él entiende por qué Dios lo hizo, pero todavía vamos a sentir como culpable un poquito porque... Pues no sabemos lo que no sabemos hasta que Dios nos alcanza y nos enseña y nos guía. I really like that. Because that's the example that I like was just saying of how, you know, you guys aren't even murderers or anything, but like God uses everybody, like even in the prisons. In the prisons, you think our worship is good? Like I heard there's prisons that worship like crazy. Everybody gets in union and praise. I just love it. I'm gonna speak on my verse real quick. It's Ephesians 2:8-9, and it says, God saved you by his grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. This is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things you have done, so none of us can boast about it. I love that, because doesn't matter how many great things you can do, like Jorge, Maggie, Nacho, these people are great. But nothing that they do can get them into heaven. It's just by the grace of God that we are all able to. But not all of us make it, because every day is a struggle. Every day is a battle. And every day, I know we're talking about God's grace, but every day we also have to fill ourselves up with prayer to recognize how good God is and remind ourselves what he's done in our lives, not just today, not what he's doing in the future, but all the battles that he's won in your life in the past. That's something to hold on to, because sometimes we get this thing called spiritual amnesia, and this is like forgetting about the great things God has done in your past, like helping you get that scholarship, helping you get that dream person, that dream job, helping you lift your skill set and being able to talk in front of people now when you were shy or scared. Like God works in us, but sometimes we get spiritual amnesia. But by God's grace, you know, he lets that us discover that on our own time, so that way we're not forced into any decisions. Because God's not like the devil that kicks the door down and forces you to do things. God is a gentleman, and he knocks on your heart and he asks for you to follow him. He asks for you to follow him. He asks for you to be with him, for you to understand him, to know who he is, because he's the only way. And I'm getting into salvation now, because that's one of the best things from God. The grace from God is a salvation. Salvation is something that is basically an eternal life. And you might think that, well, I'm 16 right now, I'm 15, I'm 14, I'm going to live forever, because I used to think that too. No, guys. You're not. Time is limited. Our time might seem like a long time, 10, 20, 30 years, But me being like a fresh dad, like I'm just so scared of time now. I don't want no time to pass. And I'm just like noticing that, oh man, I can't afford to waste 1 second without seeing my baby, without appreciating this moment. And I'm like, wow, that's how you are with us, God. After we finally get it, we can't be without 1 second without you, without appreciating the moment that you've put us in, the situation, the people, the atmosphere that you've given us. It's incredible. It's amazing. And when we really just wipe everything that we're doing, just the text messages, the phone calls, the convos, the weekend plans, the plans for your career, just wipe all that for 1 second and think you're going to be with God when your eyes close for the rest of time. And it's pretty amazing in worship. And that's not as even come close what it's going to be, how they worship in heaven, how they hang out, how great you're going to feel. It's on a whole nother level, guys. And I think that's one of the best things about God's grace, is that he doesn't charge us for salvation, because we would pay with everything that we own, because the salvation that God gives us is free. Essentially, it's free. It's just how we're willing to be, because today you can have free salvation, but tomorrow you mess up and not repent and be sour and not forgive and get your heart hardened. I don't know how you're going to be at that point if God comes. But today, if you repent, if you give it all up to God and you follow him and you don't, you try to be humble, like God's gonna give you salvation. He's going to take you with him. He's gonna remember you just the way you remembered him. And I really love that, because it's a gift from God.
And then I have a different version than yours. Mine says that, I'm going to read it from the beginning. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. So that's what you're talking about, like the faith of it. And like, you know how yours said a little bit different. It was like through works or something like that. And then right here it says through faith. So that's exactly what you're explaining, how like today you can be living a certain way. But if you decide to do the wrong thing, you take that away because of your faith. Like, because you're not believing anymore in what you cannot see and, like, what you don't know. Like, maybe you might be going through everything, but you don't know that at the end of the day, like, you're going to have your salvation. You're going to have the reward that overpasses everything, like, all of the materialistic things that we may have now. But through our faith, we are able to reach that, and we are able to have salvation and his everlasting love and his grace that is free. And all we have to do is have faith in that, in the midst of everything in our daily life, like God is always gonna come through, and he's always gonna strengthen us, and he's gonna give us the strength of a lion and like lifts us up as big as an eagle, you know, like, yeah. It says that in Isaiah, and like
it says believed in mind. So mm-hmm. I really like faith more, because that's what it is.
Yeah,
that's the power in believing. And if you believe in him today because you went to church, but tomorrow you hung out with your friends and they inflicted doubt in you and your belief is down, what does that mean? Like, because you can't drive a car without gas, and you can't run off of the Holy Spirit without faith. And I just want to give you guys an example of what it means for a person here, a human, to be full of grace. And that is basically a gift, like an unmerited gift, that's compassion, the way that you receive from others or you give to others. And that's just somebody that, like, you know, you give them instructions, or you an employee that you work with, and they're so graceful, they're so nice, they're so kind. That's having grace. And it says it here, an unmerited gift. And when I looked up God's grace and what that definition is, it straight up is just a big, bold thing that says undeserved favor. It's something that we don't deserve, but because of his heart, because of his love for us, we have it. And it's something that is freely given. It isn't, you know, excluded. Others aren't excluded. It's not limited. It's not like you trade me this, I'll trade you that. Like, it's freely given. And God's grace is for everybody. Everybody that believes in him, has faith in him. And I really like that, because there's a lot of people out there, like you said, Wendy, that feel doubt, that feel like, oh, well, it's kind of like I've done too much things that are wrong for me to go with God. Like, that is not true. That is not true. Stop believing that. Don't let the enemy carry that burden, that chain over you. And come to one of our Enfuego services and we'll talk to you. But read your word. God has favor for you. He has, you don't deserve it, but he loves you that much. And I want to say that it's not through our actions, because a lot of people think, well, I go to church Monday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It doesn't matter how many times you go, because like the word said, the last will be first and the first will be last. Somebody can come in fresh off the streets not knowing God ever in their life, but if they have that vulnerability, they have that like confidence that, like, you know what, I do believe in God because I felt something and I see these people and I'm surrounded by his word, how can I not believe? And we can lose faith here being in the church sometimes by just going outside and being of the world, by listening to music. That's why I really want to tell people out there, especially youth, if you go to church one day out of the week, if you even go to church one day out of the week, how many times are you listening to like worldly music that cusses and tells you bad stuff? One time a week or multiple times? How many video games or TV shows that you're watching that push violence, that push discrimination, that push all the things that God isn't? Because God is love, kind, beautiful, graceful. And we're watching things where like there's violence, there's discrimination, there's hate. And you come to church one day out of the seven and you expect for that to fill you up. It just doesn't. It might. I don't know. You might have that crazy flood of Holy Spirit. But I'm just letting you know, you have to refill, clean your tank, fill your cup, and be around and want to have God's presence around you. And there's nothing better than reading your Bible every day. There's nothing better than coming to service and talking with like-minded people. Oh, man, we're running out of time. Quiero hablar de Efesios 2, 8 al 9, porque por gracia sos salvos por medio de la fe, y esto no de vosotros, puede es don de Dios, no por obras, porque nadie se gloria, para que nadie se gloria. ¿Y esto qué significa? Bien fácil. Tú no te lo mereces, tú no lo mereces, pero Dios te ama tanto, aunque lo que has hecho en tus días antes o ahorita, Dios te ama ahí como estás, Dios te quiere, Dios te necesita, Dios te puede usar ahí como estás. Pero si tú dejas que esas cadenas de que el demonio que te pone arriba de ti te hagan sentir como, oh, pues ya es demasiado tarde para mí, yo ya he hecho estos errores. Yo ya tantos años en lo lodo, yo no puedo estar limpio con la camiseta blanca, hablando con los hallelujahs o lo que sea, pero Dios te quiere así como estás, porque Dios te va a usar, como dijo la historia de Wendy de Pablo. Pablo no se lo merecía la gracia de Dios. Él buscaba y mataba a los cristianos. Dios lo usó, ¿por qué? Porque él sabía que su testimonio iba a ser una poderosa arma para agarrar todos los que están caminando con esa cadenota del enemigo que te hace pensar que no te lo mereces. Porque no te lo mereces, pero Dios todavía te ama y te quiere y te puede usar. So, lo que yo quiero decir en este versículo es que la gracia de Dios, una de las más bonitas cosas de la gracia de Dios para mí, que Él me da gratis, yo no tengo que dar nada, es la salvación. Pero tengo que dar fe, tengo que creer, porque ahorita está bonito, ahorita aquí con Julissa y Wendy y Gio y todos hablando de Dios, se siente bien, se siente rico, placente, ¿verdad? Porque el Espíritu Santo está aquí. Pero ¿qué tal mañana cuando estoy solo? Cuando estoy afuera en el mundo, cuando escuchas tu música o tus movies o hablas con gente que no es de Dios y te pone duda, doubt, ¿cómo vas a estar ahí? Porque Dios, si viene en ese momento y tu fe no está así, no sé qué va a pasar. Y no te quiero asustar, pero te quiero decir que Dios te quiere arriba con él en tu vida eterna, que es la salvación, y tú no te la mereces, pero la tienes, pero tienes que tener una cosa, y esa es fe. Fe que Dios murió por ti, que Dios va a dar todo por ti. Dios mandó su único hijo para morirse por tus pecados. Eso yo lo pienso tanto. ¿Por qué eso me lo tiran tanto? ¿Por qué eso lo tira tanto la Biblia? Porque si piensas eso y no sientes humilde, like humble, algo está mal. Algo está mal porque Dios te quiere tanto que mandó su único hijo. Y te tienes que sentir, wow, Dios me ama tanto que sacrificó otro. Y era más mayor que yo, más mejor que yo, más de todo que yo. So, ¿qué soy yo? Yo no me merezco tanto amor. Y yo sé que hay muchos que piensan así, pero lo tienes. Dios te quiere y te ama. Y la gracia de Dios no lo vamos a entender, nada más lo tenemos que creer. ¿Ok? Oh, it's 8 o'clock. Guys, close your eyes. We're going to pray and be dismissed right now. Thank you, Father God, for this time. Thank you for allowing us to get here, to be able to get here safe, Father God, for protecting us on the road. Lord, I thank you for all the things that you've done in our lives in the past and now in the present and the things in the future to come. I know that your grace goes with us wherever we go, Lord. Your love for us is eternal. It's big and it's undeserved, Father God, but you give it to us, and we thank you for that. We thank you for all the things that you've done, Lord. We put you above all else. We give you priority, honor, respect, Lord, because you are amazing, you are holy, you are worthy. And I just ask that you be with those, Father God, especially those that feel like they have doubt or feel like they have chains on them of doubt, Father God, that the enemy is weighing them down, thinking that they don't deserve the love that you got to give. Thank you, Father God, because you are amazing. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. In your mighty name, we will say amen. We'll see you guys tomorrow in Fuego, so dirty.